Penguin Random House Audio presents The Penguin Book of the Modern American Short Story, edited by John Freeman. Read for you by Erin Bennett, Scott Brick, Cassandra Campbell, Frankie Corzo, Ramón de Ocampo, John Freeman, Mark Feuerstein, Kim My Guest, Deepti Gupta, Dominic Hoffman, Lisa Renee Pitts, and George Saunders.
Introduction by John Freeman. For a long time, the 1960s have been seen as a pivotal point for the modern short story. Not just the actual time period, but a version of the 1960s in popular culture. These 1960s are a time of tumult and expansion, sexual freedom, suburbanization, growth, and wealth. It was when a great nation lost its innocence and began its march toward greater liberties. More than 50 years on from this period, the 1960s seem a very different era, one in which it took riots, assassinations, and televised public beatings to wake up white Americans. Towns and cities across the country fought desegregation with violence, and even federal legislation couldn't end discriminatory practices. It just started a new movement. From the moments of their passage, the Voting Rights Act of 1965 and the Civil Rights Act of 1968 met concerted pushback. Indeed, they jump-started a right-wing movement in its ascendancy today. Even more interesting than uprisings are their aftermaths, when norms and laws resettle and the imaginations of people adjust to new horizons. In recent years, the 1970s have begun to seem like one of the most fertile periods of American life, grim as they were with stagflation, war, and the financial collapse of cities. It was also a time of environmental activism, a rising black arts movement, the emergence within film and literature of genres for reimagining society. In one five-year period, Toni Morrison, Stephen King, Maxing Hong Kingston, and Rudolfo Anaya all made their debuts. This anthology, though it tracks the high points of the short story, is enabled by spaces these writers opened up. For some, this was not a metaphorical activity. Starting in 1967, Toni Morrison began editing fiction for Random House, a post from which she nurtured books by new black voices, including Toni Cade Bambara's Gorilla My Love, 1972, which included the first story in this collection, The Lesson, about school kids on a trip from Brooklyn into Manhattan to a fancy toy store. American irreality took on a new cast in 1972, as the separation between official life and actual life in America began to yawn. The Dow closed over 1,000 for the first time, yet indicators of malaise defined the U.S. economy. Nixon was reelected in a landslide with historically low turnouts. A year later, he'd be gone. Angela Davis was released from prison, finally pronounced not guilty of murder, and was able to begin her next half-century of activism. All across America, community spaces evolved to educate and create storytellers, citizens. In her memoir, Vice President Kamala Harris describes Maya Angelou and Alice Walker coming to her after-school program in Oakland. June Jordan ran poetry workshops at Church of the Open Door in Fort Greene, Brooklyn. In the meantime, in the country's center, a new journal called Science Fiction Studies dedicated a whole issue to the work of Ursula K. LeGuin. By the time The Ones Who Walk Away from Omelas was published, LeGuin had been setting tales in Orsina, her fictional country, for over a decade. This classic dystopia disassembles one of the founding engines of so many nations, real or imagined. Whose suffering gets to be invisible for the sake of everyone else? The 1970s also saw the aftermath of second-wave feminism. One hears its questions in Grace Paley's A Conversation with My Father, in which her narrator adapts the weave of a story to make it more believable to him, then changes course, giving it a happy ending. What children learn is beautifully dramatized across several stories. In Raymond Carver's Bicycles, Muscles, Cigarettes, a child's father tries to officiate a dispute between two boys over bikes, and winds up in a fight himself. In Alice Walker's triumphantly brief The Flowers, a young girl playing outdoors stumbles upon the remains of a person, not unlike how the past mulches right in front of us. Jamaica Kincaid's girl tells all the lessons a young child in the Caribbean is meant to learn from her mother. Meantime, across the country, in a desert, the child protagonist of Lucia Berlin's phenomenal Silence pays attention to what she's not supposed to know, growing up in the shadow of unhappy people. How much more fresh air there is in the American short story when it's not presumed to be realistic, when it isn't bent toward an American dream. Louise Erdrich's The Red Convertible sets fire to such expectations with its tale of two Native American brothers and the car meant to symbolize their happiness. Isaac Bashevis Singer often made humor from the bleakest threads of American life, as he does in The Re-Encounter, where a man meets his mistress in the afterlife. The hero of Joy Williams's Taking Care stands between his wife and that next stage, whatever it be, facing down an overwhelming loss. It would take us decades to appreciate what a time the 1980s were for writers. In story, Lydia Davis puts down the driving, intense prose style that became her signature, and for which she was rediscovered overnight in the 2010s. Andrew Holleran hasn't had this moment yet, but The Penthouse, his fabulous and devastating long story, should make clear he deserves one. It's as if Maupassant were set loose on downtown New York as it careened toward the AIDS crisis. Love, in all its angles, animates these stories. In Pet Milk, Stuart Dybeck carries two young Chicagoans aloft with the same natural grace of a new love affair. Meantime, in China, Charles Johnson crawls inside a decades-old marriage that's begun to crack. In The Way We Live Now, Susan Sontag's story pours from one voice to the next, launching a daisy chain of concerns among friends, some of whom were terrified of contracting HIV, and then did. The stakes across so many stories are unbearably high, even when they chronicle why a child comes to school late, as in Sandra Cisneros' masterpiece of flash fiction, Salvador, Late or Early. In his Vietnam War story, The Things They Carried, Tim O'Brien returns individuality to his soldier characters in dehumanizing circumstances. And in River of Names, the narrator of Dorothy Allison's tale of growing up poor in the rural South, of all the things she's had to carry, steps through this grim of fiction to ask if this suffering has moved us yet. To choose these stories, I read about 1,000 works of short fiction over 2 years. Allison's question to the reader, "Is this enough? Have I flayed you?" is an apt one. How can a story move us and remain somehow true to itself? Not a trick. For this reason, when a story made a mark on me, I read it aloud, and often, then, the difference between manipulation and magic became very clear. Sadness alone never made a story great. In some stories, though, hilarity and melancholy approach a provocative meeting point, as in Dennis Johnson's Emergency, which unfolds overnight in a hospital as orderlies and nurses try to maintain their sanity. At one point, the main character, high and going for a drive, believes he's wandered into a land of gargantuan angels. Actually, it's an all-night drive-in theater, playing a film as snow begins to fall. How hard it is in a tale to capture the unexpected, the clobber of time. George Saunders does both in just 392 words in Styx, maybe the best piece of flash fiction of all time, fast on the heels of which is Tobias Wolff's Bullet in the Brain, wherein a book critic mouths off during a bank robbery and watches his entire life flash before his eyes as he pays the consequences. America is a violent country, and brutality does seep into these tales. Nathan Engländer's The 27th Man reimagines Stalin's roundup of poets, depicting the denial, absurdity, and terror of a state at war with truth. Sometimes, a family is the territory of the pain, as in Juno Diaz's Fiesta, 1980, which churns around a punishing father. Sometimes danger comes from the landscape itself. In Rick Bass's The Hermit's Tale, a naturalist tells of how she and a hiking companion got lost under a frozen lake, then navigated back to land from beneath the ice by lighting pockets of trapped gases on fire, detonating their way home. Here also is the twice-told tale, the story that unfolds on a cold night. Some of the 90s best fiction used sturdy old tools to talk about modern conditions. In Jhumpa Lahiri's A Temporary Matter, a heartsick couple from Calcutta.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.